Tonight on 2020, a celebration of the legends who left us in 2016.
Fame isn't everything,
but left so many indelible memories behind. Prince, the pop icon who started a revolution.
Dearly beloved, we are gathered here today to get through this.
Anybody who ever cooed into a microphone and harmonized it owes it to Prince.
Muhammad Ali, a fighter, a hero, in and out of the ring.
Still the greatest of all time.
America's favorite mom, Florence Henderson.
Here's the story of a lovely lady.
She met the world. I mean, she was a guiding light.
And a first lady who stood by a president but still made her own mark.
This love led her to take up the twin causes of stem cell research and Alzheimer's research.
Plus, so many other names and faces we will never forget. The newsmakers, music makers,
hallelujah,
and heroes who helped us soar.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
Saying goodbye and thank you. Good evening, I'm Elizabeth Vargas.
And I'm David Muir. As families are gathered together for this Christmas weekend and, of course, the start of Hanukkah, we thought it was the perfect time to look back and to celebrate the many legends we lost this year.
The icons who made a lasting imprint on our lives. And we start with a groundbreaking artist whose voice and larger-than-life stage persona ushered in a revolution in every way possible.
He's the best pop musician that ever lived.
My name is Prince, and I am walking.
Dig, if you will, the picture.
Anybody who ever cooed into a microphone and harmonized it owes it to Prince.
He didn't sound like anybody else. He didn't play like anybody else. He had this, as soon as he came in.
He was a game changer, one of the rare combinations of great musician, great singer, great songwriter, and great conceptualist.
The lights went out, Nikki started to grind.
He was born Prince Rogers Nelson, you know, in Minnesota. Somewhat undersized kid. He played basketball in high school.
They sent him to music teachers, and he ended up teaching the music teachers. And he was only five.
They say he learned 18 different instruments.
He was pretty much a loner, just had his guitar and just played in the basement.
Prince was kind of shy as a kid. I never thought of him like that. Whenever there was music involved, he was exact opposite of shy. He really loved music. You could just tell that it was just in him.
When he signed to Warner Brothers, they wanted to give him a producer. And Prince said, I've got to do it myself. And that was almost unheard of for a starting artist. But we saw the results.
1999 just shattered everything, and you really started paying attention to who this guy was.
2000 party oops, out of time.
Prince was the Mozart of his day.
Do you consider yourself a modern-day Mozart?
Everything that Prince did, you can't think about it without thinking about the talent.
He was the most astonishing virtuoso on keyboards and guitar of his generation. You heard it in every song he did, Let's Get Crazy.
Raspberry Beret.
She wore a raspberry beret, the kind you find in a secondhand store.
Purple Rain.
Purple Rain, Purple Rain.
It's one of the great pop ballads ever recorded.
To make it in a movie, that's something no one that decade did. Bruce Springsteen didn't make a movie. Michael Jackson didn't make a movie. Purple Rain was huge.
The winner is Prince for Purple Rain.
This is very unbelievable.
I know everyone talks about Purple Rain, but When Doves Cry is the moment we called him a genius.
This is what it sounds like when doves cry.
Incredibly autobiographical. Was he just like his mother? Was he just like his father?
You're very sweet, but you're very much to yourself. Okay. And shy?
Hmm.
I wouldn't say.
Okay.
This is a guy who didn't give interviews. He didn't pose for magazine covers. He was too shy to show up for We Are the World. But what he did kind of blew everybody's mind. He created the greatest single musical moment in the history of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction.
Thank you, Rock and Roll Hall of Fame.
Later, you know, he became a Jehovah's Witness and said that you couldn't swear around him.
If I can stop swearing, everybody can stop swearing.
You kick the edge of your bed. What do you yell?
Artichoke.
In recent years, one of the most powerful things that he did was the Super Bowl halftime show for the NFL.
Purple rain, purple rain.
The fact that the skies opened up, that's when you know that there's something else at work.
He's unfazed. He's behind like a big sheet.
For him, it's just another kind of pivotal moment in just a career of just great, great musical plateaus.
The key to longevity is to learn every aspect of music that you can.
You just look wonderful. Oh, you know you.
I'm gonna leave you all. I haven't had breakfast yet, so.
The pioneering musician Prince has died at the age of 57.
It was like an avalanche of sadness just landed on people. Fans came from all over to just be with him.
How did you feel when you heard the news today?
Devastated.
The cause of death now confirmed.
Prince died of an accidental drug overdose, self-administered fentanyl.
His death was a shock. It was also a mystery. A month after he died, we found out that he had died from a self-administered overdose of fentanyl. We also didn't realize just how severe he suffered from back pain.
We don't want him to be remembered for all the nonsense and the stories that are coming out. I want him to be remembered for the music like Diamonds and Pearls.
Diamonds and Pearls. Would you be a happy boy?
And at a time where you were either an artist or an entertainer, to be both is unbelievable. And very, very, very few people do it. That is a man who did it perfectly.
You know, you're reminded that Prince was really a genius.
So genius.
And his revolution, of course, lives on tonight. And so does the music of so many other greats.
Right, from Glenn Frey's laid-back rock to Merle Haggard's country to the original rule breaker himself, David Bowie. All of them changing our musical soundtrack.
Bowie is one of the titanic figures of rock and roll. The person who made every outsider feel like someone understood her, feel like someone understood him.
This is made to talk about.
Space Oddity said everything about David Bowie. He embraced his oddness like something from another planet. He was a true original.
Merle Haggard from Bakersfield, a rebel and an outsider. His tales were the tales that made country music great, of hard upbringing, of jail, and of hard times.
He's one of those icons that paved the way for so many people in terms of being a songwriter and being an authentic artist and being himself, do you know what I'm saying? And that's that truth that we all strive for, I think, as an artist.
I turned 21, imprisoned in life without parole.
And his songs are unforgettable. Mama Tried is fantastic.
That leaves only me to blame, 'cause Mama Tried. Heat is on. Heat is on. Heat
the Heat is On was an enormous hit. And he had so many other hits. But Glenn Frey is probably gonna be remembered most. Number one for the Eagles. And number two, Hotel California.
We were serious about our work, we were serious about the songs, but along the way, we really rocked and had a good time.
peaceful, easy feeling and take it easy. Glenn Frey's music for the Eagles created the Southern California that everybody in the world wanted to move to.
Next.
Here's the story.
America's mom, the Carol Brady you never knew.
She really could tell a good dirty joke.
You don't say.
Florence Henderson, remembered by her TV son and by her best friend, Judge Judy.
She was really quite a dame.
When we return.
Here's the story of a lovely lady.
Florence Henderson really was a lovely lady.
Who knew how to get the most out of life. She was a wonderful friend.
It was really America's mom.
She was somebody to be admired. She had an uncanny ability to make people comfortable.
You could turn on the Brady Bunch and get that life lesson.
Jan, you're really not being fair.
That you might not have been getting in your own home.
Florence was a storybook tale. She grew up poor, youngest of a gaggle of children.
Her father had a drinking problem, and her mother disappeared when she was 12. Carol Brady was the mother that she wished she had had. It's funny to think that someone who exudes such optimism, the chicken has a servant.
Wessonality.
You sure need a lot of Wessonality, you know, to deal with being the youngest of 10 kids.
She came to New York, I think she was 16 or 17 years old, with nothing. She landed within 6 months her first Broadway job.
She was plucked from relative obscurity and wound up performing in Oklahoma.
Florence Henderson did Oklahoma on stage, but in the movie, Shirley Jones got the part. Later, they became TV rivals. Here was Florence Henderson as the mom on The Brady Bunch, Shirley Jones as the mom on The Partridge Family. Come on
now. If you were of my generation, the first time you saw Florence Henderson wasn't on The Brady Bunch. You saw her on kind of this endless stream of talk shows and game shows. She was a wonderful guest on The Tonight Show and occasionally guest hosted The Tonight Show. Carol Brady was kind of the natural step from there.
Carol had to deal with everything. She had to deal with the rambunctiousness of three boys.
Oh, no!
With the squabbling of three girls.
Marsha, Marsha, Marsha!
With a dog who would steal people's dolls. And she handled all of it with a smile.
I think the Brady Bunch was the first blended family on television.
Cindy, why don't you take Bobby upstairs and tell the girls your new brothers are here, okay?
We were the first couple to sleep in the same bed to actually let people know how you get six children.
Just the idea that they might be an actual couple was a shocking thing for television.
It was such a gentle, sweet show. It's almost like your favorite children's book.
I can't talk.
I remember the Christmas episode where Carol loses her voice.
I think we ought to postpone Christmas till Mom can talk again.
Miraculously, after Cindy asks Santa Claus for a miracle.
You must want something for Christmas.
I do. I want my mommy to get her voice back.
One is granted.
Sing, Annie, sing.
Oh, come all ye faithful, oh, come let us.
And she's singing Come All Ye Faithful, beautifully, I might add. The only episode in which Florence got to sing, if I'm not mistaken.
I did worry a lot about Carol Brady being too sweet.
People who knew Flo well know that she has a saucy and spicy sense of humor. Never the shy, retiring Mrs. Brady that people often thought of her as. Told a great dirty joke.
And it tickled her, because she's so Mary Poppins-like at one end, and at the other end, she's got a lot of puck in her.
Carol Brady!
MTV hired the Brady Bunch to reenact the top scenes from the movies in 1992. One was A Few Good Men.
I want the truth!
Greg! You can't handle the truth.
Did you order Marsha's grounding?
Yeah, right I did. Now you go to your room.
And, wait a minute, it gets worse. Sharon Stone in Basic Instinct.
Would you tell us the nature of your relationship with Sam the Butcher?
I had sex with him for about a year and a half. I liked having sex with him.
Florence Henderson said that on television, so God bless her.
When she did Dancing with the Stars, Flo was doing a very sexy and provocative tango.
She was sexy for an older woman.
And she was really moving it.
One of her last public appearances was on Dancing with the Stars. She was there to support Maureen McCormick, who had played her daughter on the Brady Bunch. She really was a very, very nice, really extraordinary woman.
Flo was one of those ageless and timeless people that you really expect to be around forever.
And we'll all miss her. And we should all hope to be as good to one another as she was to everyone.
A TV son on the mother we all loved. And we sadly said goodbye to so many other performers this year.
Both actors who transported us with their work on the big screen to those we welcomed into our homes every week on television.
It was a sad year for TV lovers because we lost another iconic TV mom, Doris Roberts.
I can contribute. I'm not just some trophy wife.
She will always be remembered for Marie, everybody's mom, but also your worst nightmare of a mother-in-law.
You found a recipe. Oh, you're a cook now.
What people may not know about Doris Roberts is she had decades of brilliance. She was one of the great comic actresses who ever lived.
Alan Thicke won the loyalty of American audiences by playing the dad who didn't always have the answers.
As I smack you in the head, there's no risk of doing any damage.
Even though he wasn't like an actor by trade.
Those sofa cushions are not for hitting.
Growing Pains was perfect for him. He wound up writing a whole bunch of theme songs, shows like Different Strokes and The Facts of Life.
The Facts of Life.
But it's that character, Dr. Seaver, that we remember him. Gary Marshall could take whatever you were doing and make it five times funnier. Like what he did with The Odd Couple. That show was hysterical. And then he, of course, went on to do Happy Days. Probably his most iconic hit. He made Henry Winkler into a teen idol. And then he went on to do Pretty Woman, which made Julia Roberts an absolute superstar.
And you'll be.
The idea that Gene Wilder would be best known for Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory is a thought that would have surprised anyone who was watching movies when Willy Wonka and the Chocolate Factory came out. Gene Wilder goes to cinematic heaven because of the producers, period.
And tell me, who are you?
I'm Leo Bloom.
Everything he says in that movie is perfect.
Oh, I fell on my keys.
His collaboration with Mel Brooks on movies like The Producers, on Young Frankenstein.
It's alive!
You know, those are some of the funniest movies ever made.
Next, how the world learned the champ had died.
We are coming on the air with that breaking news.
Saying goodbye to a hero.
We'll be a killer and a thriller when I get the gorilla in Manila.
With the wit that was his trademark.
Do you believe in fidelity when you're married? Nobody's listening.
When we return.
We are coming on the air with that breaking news.
It was a Friday night and word began to spread.
Boxing legend
Muhammad Ali,
the 20th century's greatest fighter.
It was like a world leader was passing.
The boxer once named Sportsman of the Century has died.
Everyone understood that for multiple generations, this was a titanic figure.
I'm handsome, I'm fast, I'm pretty, and can't possibly be beat.
Muhammad Ali was everything. He was gorgeous, he was gifted, he talked trash, he could back it up.
I am the king of the world! Hold it, hold
he was everything. An elegant man in a brutal, violent sport.
Look like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Ah!
The way he fought in the ring was poetry in motion, but the way he lived his life was poetry in motion.
Only last week, I murdered a rock, injured a stone, hospitalized a brick. I'm so mean, I make medicine sick.
Stories of a rambling man, like the same old song with a different name.
Muhammad Ali was born Cassius Clay in the very segregated city of Louisville, Kentucky.
He had a hard scrabble upbringing of sorts and found that boxing would be a useful way out at some point. He won the light heavyweight gold medal at the 1960 Rome Olympics.
Cassius Clay, the winner for the USA.
And this was the first sense that we had that this was a boxer who was going to make an impression.
Hello, everybody. I'm Steve Ellis here at ringside for that World Heavyweight Championship fight.
In 1963, he got a title shot against Sonny Liston, who was then the heavyweight champion of the world. I was in kindergarten, and I remember my school bus driver saying to me, you know, like when your mama chops the meat? That's what Liston's going to do to Clay. Didn't happen.
That might be all, ladies and gentlemen.
He wins the heavyweight championship of the world.
I don't have a mark on my face,
yes.
And I upset Sonny Liston, and I just turned 22 years old. I must be the greatest.
When Cassius Clay changed his religion from Christianity to the Nation of Islam, many people didn't know how to react, black and white. Oh my gosh, what's he done? People were so suspicious of it.
I would like for you to call me by my name now. Muhammad Ali.
It was massively controversial. In the world of sports, which was controlled by old white people, people were terrified.
I saw him as critically important to smashing the traditions.
He gave up a lot for his politics, and he was criticized and even vilified by many people.
The real enemies of my people are right here, not in Vietnam.
Mr. Muhammad Ali has just refused to be inducted into the United States Armed Forces.
Muhammad Ali gets a draft notice and refuses to go fight in Vietnam.
I'm not going to help nobody get something my Negroes don't have. If I'm going to die, I'll die now, right here fighting you.
That won him enemies in many corners of America.
One of his most famous statements was, ain't no Viet Cong ever called me the N-word. And that said a lot for how black Americans felt about the Vietnamese War.
What happens now to his title? He will doubtless be stripped of it, and he will no longer be the champion.
He lost the heart of his athletic career because he refused to fight in Vietnam. Now, that doesn't make him Nelson Mandela, but it was something. And it was striking to many Americans that he not only had beliefs, but he stood up for them.
I'm not sure that there's anybody left, really, for you to fight.
You.
That may come about someday. Thank you for coming.
Just stay in shape.
I have wrestled with an alligator. I done tussled with a whale. I done handcuffed lightning, throw thunder in jail.
In 1974, Ali Foreman, in the country of Zaire, the rumble in the jungle.
The people do chant Ali Bumaye. That means Ali killer.
The whole thing is captured in a remarkable film called When We Were Kings.
Too much speed, boy! Too fast!
Ali Bumaye!
At the time, everyone thinks Foreman is going to obliterate him. Instead, Ali is up against the ropes, he covers up, and Foreman just wails at him. Roping him, he tired Foreman out.
Taking advantage as Foreman's head was bent.
Ali put him away.
It's over! Muhammad Ali recaptures the heavyweight championship of the world. Will be a killer, and a chiller, and a thriller when I get the gorilla in Manila.
The thrill of Manila is one of the most epic prize fights of all time.
Ali said he almost died in the ring against Joe Frazier.
It's brutal. And maybe we lost a piece of Ali that night. But at the same time, it's his most courageous performance.
Muhammad Ali has won the fight.
Still the greatest of all time.
It's 14 years since you became heavyweight champion of the world. And you say now that you're going to win it for the third time. You will be the only man ever to have regained the title.
Three times.
What if you don't?
No, I don't.
But it's a way of life for you. It's money. It's an entourage. It's yourself.
I'd give it all up tomorrow, find a job pumping gas in a gas station if I had to, and be happy.
Really?
Yes, ma'am.
In 1981, Muhammad Ali finally retires from boxing. But 3 years later, he's diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. What a sad irony that this man who made his living and made his impression on most of us because of his ability to speak so well, he lost that gift. In 1996 in Atlanta, he has the electric torch and he's shaking. He's really struggling. Will he make it? And then he rose to the occasion, leaned in, and lit the Olympic torch. And Atlanta went crazy.
Your name is Muhammad Ali.
He was the most charismatic athlete ever. and he had influence in every sphere of American life. There's never been anybody like him.
He was funny. He was beautiful. He was the most perfect athlete you ever saw, and those were his own words. Ali forced us to take a look at ourselves. This brash young man who thrilled us, angered us, confused, and challenged us. He is gone, but he will never die.
And I want everybody out there to know it. I am the greatest.
Saying goodbye to the greatest, and really so many other greats in the world of sports.
From a golf course to a basketball court, even those behind the broadcast microphone.
It's all about the players. I like to see young people succeed.
Have something and destiny.
I always think I have something to teach them.
If I've learned anything through all of this, it's that each and every day is a canvas waiting to be painted.
My bat and my glove could not get me close to the Hall of Fame. I know that. I'm lucky, proud, and I'm grateful. Thank you.
I always say one thing, that if I can teach a young man coming along to leave the game better when they leave than they found it when they arrived, then I've been successful.
He's the best.
When we return, Nancy Reagan, the gracious and elegant First Lady who lived the words in sickness and in health.
If a death can be peaceful and lovely, that one was.
Her love story with Ronald Reagan, next.
We gather here today to say goodbye to Nancy Davis Reagan. A woman without whom Ronald Wilson Reagan would never have become the 40th President of the United States. They met at a Hollywood restaurant. The dinner would be brief, they agreed, because each had an early casting call. But when I opened the door, she wrote later, I knew he was the man I wanted to marry.
How do you know so much about the moon?
I know a lot about it. Spend all my time looking at it when you're away.
Clark Gable had a line once that I thought was very eloquent. There's nothing more wonderful for a man than to approach his own doorstep, knowing that someone on the other side of the door is listening for the sound of his footsteps.
How do you keep the romance in a marriage?
I think it used to be that everything had to be your way, or 50-50. And it isn't always 50-50.
What is it?
Sometimes it's 90-10. And you have to be willing to give the 90, or he has to be willing to give the 90. But it's something you want to do.
I, Ronald Reagan, do solemnly swear.
Here was Nancy Reagan with the beautiful clothes. She was very elegant. She brought elegance to the White House.
He was the visionary, he was the big picture guy, but she was the detail person, and she was the personnel director. She made sure he had good people around him, and when they weren't good, she had to get rid of them.
Mr. Reagan has finally decided that he does need a new chief of staff. Don Regan is out.
I think we can admit that she was not always the easiest person to deal with. She could be difficult, she could be demanding. You didn't want to get on Mom's bad side.
The president was hit. He was hit in the left chest, but he is in stable condition.
The only time I saw her lose her composure was the day the president was shot. She was devastated, and in fact, she fell apart.
I was a very good worrier. Did he know how much you worried?
I think so. He would refer that to me often.
Our love is here to stay.
Nancy, who might have preferred a more private life, became the consummate political wife and first lady.
What will you do when someone offers you drugs? Yes,
he owed much of the success of his presidency to her.
Former President Ronald Reagan this afternoon released a letter to the American people disclosing that he has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. In his handwritten letter, Mr. Reagan says, "I only wish there was some way I could spare Nancy from this painful experience."
He's a dear, sweet, wonderful man.
And do the clouds part someday?
Occasionally.
Saying things to you, knowing you?
Sometimes.
You think he still knows how much you love him?
Oh, yes. Yes, he does.
There are few who are not moved by the love that Ms. Reagan felt for her husband, and fewer still who are not inspired by how this love led her to take up the twin causes of stem cell research and Alzheimer's research.
You could save millions of people's lives if you really charged ahead with stem cell. Hopefully we will.
President Ronald Reagan has died this afternoon in Los Angeles. He was 93 years old.
If a death can be peaceful and lovely, that one was. Ronnie all of a sudden turned his head and looked at me and opened his eyes and just looked. And then he closed them. What a gift he gave me at that point. What a wonderful gift.
My parents were two halves of a circle, closed tight around a world in which their love for each other was the only sustenance they needed.
Next, from a man who orbited the Earth.
Oh, that view is tremendous.
To one who ruled with an iron fist.
Do you think that you will die as a leader of Cuba?
When we come back.
We turn now to the newsmakers who shaped our world in so many ways. From a dictator who stared down the U.S. to a Supreme Court judge, a Holocaust survivor who vowed never to forget, to the first man who orbited the Earth.
Godspeed, John Glenn.
Zero G, and I feel fine. Capsule is turning around. Oh, that view is tremendous.
I'd like to be cocky enough to think that I did a good job on that flight, which I did.
Welcome to Washington. Welcome back to this planet.
But I think whoever had done a good job on that thing, it would have been a great comeback for America at that time.
I was a young kid growing up in New Jersey. I mean, he was one of my heroes. I mean, he fought in World War II as a fighter pilot, again in Korea, was one of the original seven astronauts, and by the way, served for 25 years in the United States Senate.
I guess I've looked at my whole life as being a sort of service to my country.
When it was announced that John Glenn would fly again on the space shuttle in 1999, I mean, we thought it was pretty awesome. To have one of your heroes there working with you in the astronaut office was pretty exciting.
Booster ignition and liftoff of Discovery with a crew of six astronaut heroes and one American legend.
One thing I promised Annie the day we were married, in addition to our wedding vows, of course, was that I would do everything I could to keep life from being boring.
John Glenn became a hero in every sense of the word.
I, Antonin Scalia, do solemnly swear.
I, Antonin Scalia, do solemnly swear.
Getting nominated to the Supreme Court is the culmination of a dream, of course.
Justice Scalia, in many ways, was larger than life. I think that came through in his oral arguments. He would sometimes pounce on the advocates. He found weaknesses in their arguments, and he sort of would not let them go until they had satisfied him.
The Constitution is not meant to facilitate change. It is meant to impede change, to make it difficult to change.
I don't think that he thought of himself as an ideologue at all. I think that he thought he had a rigorous method of interpretation that largely, but not exclusively, led to conservative results.
I love to argue. I've always loved to argue. It may well be that I'm something of a shin kicker.
A man who has made no enemies is probably not a very good man.
The personal Scalia was pretty universally agreed to be funny and witty and charming.
I've criticized the opinions of some of my colleagues, and we have remained friends, just as they have criticized my opinions, and we have remained friends.
I'd say people might regard my opinions as rather dull, boring. Yours are really jazzy sometimes.
For Justice Scalia, a fitting farewell.
He influenced a generation of judges, lawyers, and students, and profoundly shaped the legal landscape.
A revolution is not the job of a man. A revolution is the matter and the job of a people.
He outlasted 10 presidents in the United States, and he remained a symbol for Cuban independence.
I remember I was 5 and a half the day Fidel Castro and his rebels came into Havana as supposedly the liberators of the Cuban people.
I think that Fidel Castro will be remembered as a terrible tyrant.
Do you still have many political prisoners?
Yes, we do have some. Around a little bit more than 1,000, maybe 2,000 or 3,000.
The Cuban Missile Crisis, where Fidel Castro decided that he could be a bigger thorn in the side of the United States.
Yes, we were very close to the nuclear war, extremely close. I said to Khrushchev, there is going to be an attack.
The fall of the Soviet Union led Cuba to this worst financial crisis.
I am not afraid of saying I'm a convinced communist. I feel honored of being a communist, and I hope I will be till the last breath.
All of us here in America watched as President Obama traveled to Cuba, and the president sat down with us, invited us to witness the moment with him. And I'll never forget, you know, walking with him in old Havana, a moment that just a couple of years ago would have seemed impossible to imagine.
Change is going to come from within Cuba, but they'll have to decide what Cuba will look in the future.
Next, the music makers. Hallelujah. Memory makers.
I can see what's happening. I'm the schmuck in this story, aren't I?
And even the man behind a rebel robot named R2-D2. Before we say goodnight, we want to remember some of the other greats who left us this year. They entertained us, they informed us, they moved us, and left us with these treasured moments we will always remember.
I've heard there was a secret chord.
Really? Fame isn't everything, is it, Mr. Potter?
Careful music, do you?
Tell Mike it was only business. I always liked him.
I can see what's happening. I'm the schmuck in this story, aren't I?
Hallelujah. You know something? You're all right.
Hallelujah. I mean, I always figure if you can't afford to go first class, charge it.
Hallelujah.
But darling, a girl can't make a success on instincts alone.
I need someone older and wiser telling me what to do.
Oh, baby, I've been here before. I've seen you. I've walked this floor. I used to.
Welcome to the first and the only 2008 vice presidential debate.
It's not.